date, but I forwarded the letter over to both of our, the co-chairs of our church from the National Mall Caucus. We started a ministry, the Global Board of Missions started missions in Laos about 2001. And so since that time, when they first started, they sent the first missionary to Laos. His name was Reverend Chu from St. Paul, Minnesota. And so he went and stayed there for a couple years until he got, until he got older and he became ill and stuff like that. So he came back home. And afterwards, they sent Reverend Daniel from Wisconsin to go to Laos. And so currently right now in Laos, there's four missionaries in Laos. And since early 2000s, they've been able to build up 74 churches in Laos, as well as train 60 pastors. And like I said, there's four missionaries there. But all this time, they have been operating under the table, or in other words, not officially or illegally. So, they want to be able to register themselves as a United Methodist Church denomination in Laos. And so they're budgeting and asking us to support that. For us pastors, they require for each of us to donate $1,000, which we'll have to do. But they're also looking for other people who are willing to support the ministry, so that way they can go and actually register these 74 churches into a denomination over there. Right now, they're working with the LDC, and the LDC is kind of like the state church in Laos. But they are more geared towards the CMA than they are towards the United Methodist Church. And so their polity, because the CMA have worked with them for a long time, and so the way that they practice their religion, their liturgy, and things of that sort is more similar to the CMA, and so it's a little bit different from us as the United Methodist Church. For example, here in the United Methodist Church, we ordain women as pastors. The CMA, they don't. Things of that sort. Also, when we do communion, we do open communion. In the CMA and the LDC, when they do communion, you have to be baptized first before you can take part of communion. So things like that makes it a little difficult for the Methodists in Laos to work with the LDC and with the CMA. So it's one of the things that's why they really want us to try to support them so they can register themselves as an official denomination. So that way, as an official denomination, one of the things that can happen is that the government can come and just shut them down at any time. So that's one of the things that they're scared of. And so their budget right now is $20,000, and we've been able to collect about $7,500. And so we're still $12,500 short. So just let us know ahead of time. I'll talk more about that at a later date. Share more information with us about that. Okay? And so those are my announcements. This time I'd like to invite anybody else who would like to make any other announcements.
We have a trustee meeting. We have a trustee meeting after church today.
Thank you, Susan.
Just a little reminder that if we'd like to have coffee hour, we need to sign up for it. And greeters, that's very simple. In fact, I was talking to Pat this morning that she could just sit out there and people would go to her, because they do, just because she looks so inviting and she wants to give them hugs and chat for a bit. So I might just sign her up for a regular.
Thank you. Okay, I'm just getting more announcements. It's time for us to greet each other for the passing of the peace.
Thank you.
Please stand with me if you're able to join me for the call to worship. Let us worship the one who calls us.
His mercy reigns, unending love, amazing grace.
God, you are forever. You will be ours, Father. We thank you so much for your love and your grace, that you continue to watch over us and bless us on a daily basis. Today, as we come before you to worship you, we ask for your presence to be with us. We cannot do this without your presence. And so we ask that the Holy Spirit rain down upon us and empower us for this time of worship. And so we pray in the name of the Lord Jesus Christ. Amen. You may all be seated. At this time, it's time for us to give the Old Testament reading. It's time for us to share our joys and our concerns with the Lord.
Just wanted to know that you were in my prayers and in my thoughts the whole time we were gone. I know it seems like when we leave that we leave you, but we really don't. You're there. So I just want you to know that I appreciate, and I know that you remember us too, because when we arrive you say, where have you been? You missed us.
Who are you?
First.
Just continued prayers for Helen Bell as she struggles with the vertigo. I'm assuming it's not any better since she's not here this morning. So just continued prayers for Helen.
Okay, well, my granddaughter, I think I reported last week or whenever, that my granddaughter just got married. Well, she also had just graduated from Chico State with her RN, and so now, and then she got married, and now she just got accepted into Georgetown University's online midwifery program where she'll become a nurse practitioner. She wants to go into the midwifery program, so I'm pretty proud of her. Kayla is her name.
Praise God.
Just want to say that since I moved down here, it seems like God is just miraculously arranging things for me to be a better.
Praise God. Okay, let us praise God. Dear God, we thank you so much for all the things that you give to us, the blessings that you continue to bless us with. We thank you so much for this fellowship, for this church, for bringing us together through your Son, Jesus Christ, allowing us to get to know each other as we walk on this journey of faith together as one church. We ask that you continue to bless us with your ministry, that you will continue to, that through us, that you will continue to proclaim your message and your love and your grace throughout this community. We pray that we will become a church that we are. Of a church that brings much, much glory to you. Father, we also thank you so much for your Son, Jesus Christ, who you sent to die for us on the cross, the sufferings that he went through, the sacrifices that he made for us. We We are forever in gratitude of your love. We are forever in gratitude of your Son, Jesus Christ. We thank you so much for giving us your Holy Spirit as he lives among us and empowers us for the ministry, as he blesses us and leads us into the truth, as he lives inside our hearts and sanctifies us. We thank you so much for your words, the words that continue to teach us, continue to reveal to us your will for us as your church, for us as United Methodists. Father, we thank you so much for our Hmong congregation. We thank you so much for our missions in Laos, the things that you've been able to do, the things that you've been able to bless us with, sending missionaries who are willing to sacrifice many things, give up many things, many of the things that makes them comfortable here in this country to live in a third world country, to be able to just lead people to you. We're so thankful that today we have 74 churches in Laos. So Father, we ask that you continue to bless them, and as they seek for support, we ask that you strengthen us here in the United States, that we will be able to open up our hearts to give them support that's necessary for them to be able to continue with their ministry, to be able to continue with their churches, to be able to build churches more and more for your sake of your kingdom. We pray for all those who are suffering poverty in that country, Father. We ask that your power be among them. As United Methodists, we are not only there to simply just build churches for fathers, United Methodists, we are there to help them in every way possible, including providing them with an education, providing them, helping them with their economy, trying to get them their economy going. So, Father, we pray that you continue to support them, continue to bless us as we do these missions work, not only in Laos, but throughout the entire globe, to every nation, where all nations belong to you. Father, we pray for our country, we pray for the leaders of our nation, that they will continue to fear you in all the things that they do, that they will continue to see you, that they will continue to understand your will, that everything that they do is based upon knowing who you are, Father. That we as a country will continue to be a country that does everything based upon what you have taught us, based upon the blessings that you have given to all of us, Father. Father, not only that, Father, today we're so thankful. We're so thankful for our own church members, for Alma and for Neil, and as they have been traveling throughout. We're so happy that you've been keeping them safe throughout this whole time, and we're so happy, so glad to have them back with us here today, Father. We ask that you continue to bless them throughout, Father, not only that, we also lift up Helen to you as she suffers through this illness. Father, we ask that your healing power be among her, to be with her and provide her healing as you have desired. Father, not only that we celebrate Kayla, who have been accepted into Georgetown University, we ask that you continue to bless her with much, much success throughout her studies and throughout her career, Father. That all the success and all the achievements that she makes, Father, all of them will bring much glory to you. Not only that, Father, we're thankful for P.W. for being with us, for leading him here to our church, to be a part of us, to come here to worship with us, Father. This blessing to our church. We ask that you continue to be with them also. And so as your children and as your church, we pray the prayer that your Son Jesus Christ taught us. Our Father, who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done, on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread. And forgive us our trespasses, as we forgive those who trespass against us. And lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For thine is the kingdom, the power, and the glory forever. Amen. Please stand with me if you're able to. Turn the red hymn over to page 436. Page 436, the voice of God is called.
Thank you.
You know, these past few months, we've had about 5 babies born to our church, including a set of twins. And so it's been a tremendous blessing for our church as God has blessed us with these newborn babies. And one of the things that studies show is that these babies, while they're still in the mother's womb, that about six to seven months, when they're still inside the womb, but they're able to already recognize their mother's voice. And at the same time, they're able to hear other people's voice. They're able to hear noises while they're inside the womb. But yet, the very voice that brings them much comfort is the voice of their mother. And so when their mom is singing, when the mother is singing, it brings them much relief while they're still in the womb. And even though they hear all these different voices, they know that, you know what, that voice or that this voice or that voice, that doesn't belong to my mom. But when my mom speaks, they love to listen to just to the voice of their mother. And as Christians, that's one of the things that we need to also come to recognize, is we also need to come to recognize the voice of our Lord Jesus Christ, the voice of our God. But what the Bible teaches us is that the Bible teaches us that they're also just like the child, just like the baby when the baby is still in the womb, that the child is able to hear many, many different voices. One of the things that the Bible teaches us is that there are many, many different voices, even for us as Christians. And with all these voices that we hear speaking to us, that we need to be able to discern which voice is the voice of God. You know, as Christians, one of the things we often want to know is, we often want to know what God's will is for our lives. In order for us to understand God's will, is for us to really be able to identify, for us to be able to discern the voice of God. You know, many times we have to make decisions in our everyday lives. As we make those decisions in our everyday lives, we want to be able to discern God's voice in our lives. So we can make those decisions. Those decisions are decisions that will bring much glory to our Lord. I know oftentimes when we talk about people hearing the voice of God, we often think that these people are crazy, right? That they have some kind of mental issue. And there are times that people are crazy and they just hallucinate, they hear all kinds of voices. But that's not what we're talking about today. We're not talking about people who are having mental issues and things of that sort. We're not talking about people who are hallucinating or anything like that. But we are talking about what Jesus Christ is saying here. And he says that my sheep, they listen to my voice. They know my voice, they listen to my voice, and they follow. They follow me. And so, as Christians, that's what Jesus says, is that as Christians, we are to be able to identify what his voice is. We are supposed to be able to discern his voice so that way we can follow him. So we can follow Jesus Christ. And so the scriptures teaches us that there's many different voices. First off, there's the voice of man. Now, the voice of man is easy for us to discern because it's an audible voice. We see the person talking to us. We see in Acts chapter 5:29 the apostles and Peter as they were speaking. And here in Acts chapter 5:29 says, then Peter and the other apostles answered and said, we ought to obey God rather than men. And so this voice, the voice of man, is easy for us to discern. It's easy for us to tell when they're speaking to us because it's an audible voice coming from someone. One of the challenges for our mom ministry is that oftentimes we simply pay attention to the voice of the pastor and we don't really seek out the voice of God. Because the pastor, a lot like the shaman, the pastor has taken the shaman's position in our own culture. And so we rely so much on the voice of the pastor, the voice of a man, rather than the voice of God. Here in America, one of the challenges that we often face here in Western Christianity is the voice of culture. We often listen to the voice of culture. It dictates to us our faith. We follow the culture. Many times we don't listen to the voice of God, but we listen to the voice of culture. When we're down and over at the annual conference, they broke us up into little groups. And in these little groups, there's lay people, and there's pastors and clergy. We sat around just talking about certain things that's going on within the church. And one of the gentlemen in my small group said to us as pastors, and he said this, he said, you know what, if I was to go to a church, and if any pastor ever talks about marriage from the Bible, I'm getting up and leaving because I don't believe in the Bible. I don't believe in the scriptures. I don't believe in what the Bible has to say about marriage. And so a lot of times, and you know, he talks about culture and things of that sort. And so a lot of times we ignore what God teaches us, but we look to culture. Other times we look to the past. Many times for young people nowadays, they look to athletes. They look to entertainers. They look to movie stars. Many times we even look to politicians to be the voice for us. And we follow the voice of these people. Whatever party we belong to, we follow the political leaders for that party. But what the Word of God teaches us, that when it comes to the voice of man, that when it comes to the voice of man, that we are only to follow the voice of man when he does not conflict with God. When he does not conflict with God. Then there's another voice that the Bible talks about, and that is the voice of Satan. Now, one of the things that Satan has done for us here in Western Christianity, many times he's taught us that Satan does not even exist anymore. He has convinced us that he does not exist. Many times he's convinced us that God does not exist anymore. A lot of times that's one of the challenges that we have as Christians, is whether or not we are actually convicted that Jesus Christ did it, or whether or not we're convicted that God actually exists. And many times we go to church without this conviction. Many times we take part of the ministry of the church without the conviction existence of Jesus Christ or the existence of God himself. But the voice of Satan, one of the ways that we can recognize the voice of Satan as according to scriptures is that the scripture teaches us that he is the father of lies. That Satan is the father of lies. So his voice is a voice that lies to us. And we see how he lied to Adam and Eve in Genesis chapter 3. But God told them that they will certainly die if they were to eat from the tree of knowledge. Satan came before them. And in Genesis chapter 3, verse 4, Satan said to them, "You will not certainly die." You see, so he takes the word of God and totally twists it around, and he says, "You don't have to trust in God. God is just lying to you. God is not telling you the truth. You know, but believe in me, because you will not certainly die. You can eat from that tree, you won't die." And the rest is history. We understand what happened. We know the history of that, what happened after Adam and Eve ate from the tree. Another thing that we see from Satan is that his voice is a voice that tries to deceive us. And we go back to the account of Genesis chapter 3, we can also see in the account of Jesus being tempted in the wilderness. But today I want to focus us in the Garden of Eden. In Genesis chapter 3, verse 1, Satan came before them, and he said this to them. He said, "Did God really say you must not eat from any tree?" You see, I want us to pay attention to that. He says, did God really say you must not eat from any tree in the garden? Now, if we're going to go back to Genesis chapter 2, we see that God never said that. Right? God never said that. In Genesis chapter 2, what God told them was that God actually told them that you can actually eat from any tree except the tree of knowledge. And yet, here comes Satan, and he's saying, "You know what? Did God really say that you must not eat from any tree at all?" So we see that what Satan does, the voice of Satan, what he does is first, he lies to us. The second thing is he tries to twist the word of God to deceive us. To deceive us. The third thing we see from the voice of Satan is that he leads us to rebel against God. He says in Genesis chapter 3, verse 4, B, the second part of verse 4, and he says to them that, "You know what? You will actually be like God. That if you eat from this tree, you will actually be like God." In other words, what he's saying is that God is trying to keep you from experiencing your full potential. God is trying to keep you down. And so it's okay for you to rebel against God. It's okay for you to sin. Sometimes we often hear this idea that it's okay for you to sin. God will just forgive you for it. But the Word of God teaches us that the grace of God is not there for us to sin. It's there to lead us to Christ. The Word of God teaches us, here in the accounts of Genesis chapter 3, Satan is trying to get them to believe that they can become the ones to determine right from wrong. He says that, you know what, you would know right from wrong. And God does not want you to do that. And so that's why God does not want you to eat from that tree. And so we see three things here. The first thing is that the voice of Satan lies to us. The voice of Satan deceives us. And then the voice of Satan encourages us to rebel against God. It teaches us that it's okay for us to sin against God. And what the scripture teaches us about this voice is that we're never, never, ever to listen to the voice of Satan. The third voice that the Bible often talks about is the voice of self. Your own voice, when you're talking to yourself. We see in Luke chapter 18, verse 4, the parable of the persistent widow and of the judge. And Jesus Christ says this about the judge. He says, but he finally said to himself. And so the voice of yourself, when you're talking to yourself, it can either be your own thoughts or it can be just you ought to be talking to yourself. Now, one of the things that we often talk about is self-love, which is something that the Bible does encourage us, is to love ourselves. But we must be careful with that. We must be careful that we don't love ourselves to the point that we become selfish, to the point that we elevate ourselves above God, just like how Satan wanted to do. That was the sin of Lucifer. The sin of Lucifer was that he wanted to become God himself because he was leading worship. He was the most powerful of all the angels, the most beautiful of all the angels. And so he wanted the throne for himself. He wanted to replace God himself. That was his sin. And so even if we're to love ourselves, our love is to humble us. It's not to lift us above God. It's not to lift us, to make us to be higher than God in any way or shape or form or anything of that sort. And so the Bible says to us in Proverbs chapter 14, verse 12, about ourselves, he says that there is a path that seems right to men, but leads to destruction. There is a path that seems right to man, but leads to destruction. So many times you might think that your thoughts are correct. Many times we may think that our ways are correct, but that way might not be the way that God intends us to go. And so we need to seek out the voice of God to know. And if we don't seek out the will of God, we'll seek out the voice of God. And if we're to go continue on that path, then what it's going to do is going to lead us towards destruction. In Proverbs chapter 3, verse 5 and verse 6, one of my favorite Bible verses, it says, trust in the Lord with all your heart. When it talks about us, it talks about trusting the Lord with all your heart and not lean on your own understanding. In all your ways, submit to him, and he will make your path straight. The voice of self, the voice of self. And whether, even though we're to love ourselves, we must understand that this love for ourselves is to submit ourselves God, not to elevate us above God, not to become gods ourselves, but to humble ourselves before the Lord, to trust in the Lord. And then the fourth voice is the voice of God. It is the voice of God. And the Bible tells us that there is a God. In order for us to hear, in order for us to be able to discern the voice of God, is that we must believe that there is a God. That we must believe that there is a God. Genesis chapter 1, verse 1, the very first verse of the Bible goes on and says, in the beginning, God created the heavens and the earth. You know, the Bible never spends any time trying to convince us that God exists. It simply assumes the existence of God. And so this is where everything starts, is that whether or not do we have faith in the existence of God? Because if we have no conviction in the existence of God, we will never be able to identify God's voice because there is no God, right? If you don't believe in God, you're not going to be able to identify his voice. And so the first thing we must realize is that there is a God. The second thing is that this God, he communicates to us. That's when we talked about the story of Naaman, and we saw how God communicated to Naaman. That God used a slave girl to speak to Naaman, to tell Naaman to go to Israel to receive healing for his leprosy. We see the story of King David. After he sinned with Bathsheba, God used the prophet Nathan to go before King David to ask David to repent of his sin. This is how God spoke to him. We see in the Old Testament all the prophets speaking to the nation of Israel. And many times, the Israelites at that time, they rejected the message of the prophets. We've also studied in the past about that the entire Bible is written by God. That the Holy Spirit is the author of the scriptures. That he is the one that to write the scriptures. And even though he used men to write the scriptures, that the actual author of all of scripture is the Holy Spirit. And so one of the things that we need to ask ourselves is that how many times do we actually consult with the scriptures before making a decision in our lives? Oftentimes, I'm guilty of this myself, but oftentimes we don't. Oftentimes, even our ministry in the church, when we do ministry, we go about doing things without consulting what God wants us to do. And we try to seek out our own will instead of seeking out the will of God, instead of seeking out what God wants us to do. And we see here, John chapter 10, verse 27, it says, "My sheep listen to my voice. I know them and they follow me." And so to recognize his voice, we need to be part of his sheep. We need to be his sheep. And that's one of the difficult things. That's one of the challenges for us as Christians is that we often come to church for many years. But the question is whether or not we belong to the sheep of Christ. Because we can come to church our whole life without belonging to this group. That's one of the challenges that we must continue to examine ourselves ensure that we are in the faith. There's an old saying that, you know, just being in the garage doesn't make you into a car, right? Coming to church does not actually make us a Christian. And so Jesus Christ is saying that my sheep, those who are mine, they will listen to my voice, they will hear my voice, they will know my voice, and I will know them, and I will know them, and they will follow me. That's one of the things that gives us great challenge. Continue to challenge ourselves to see, am I really in the faith? Am I really in the faith of God? What we also must understand is that God has something important to say. To say to us. God always has something important to say to us. In Hebrews chapter 3, verse 7, it says, "So as the Holy Spirit says, today if you hear his voice, do not harden your hearts as you did in the rebellion during the time of testing in the wilderness." The rebellion here is talking about Israel's rebellion against God as God led them out of Egypt, led them out of slavery. And here we see today tells us that today God is still speaking to his people. That today God is still speaking to us through his revelation, through his word, through other Christians, that God is still speaking to us. So how do we reason through this? How do we reason with God's will? How do we work ourselves through this? We know the Roman Catholic Church. We know the reason why we got out of the Roman Catholic Church is because in the Roman Catholic Church, the person with the authority is pretty much the Pope. While they believe in the scripture, their ultimate authority really comes from how the Pope interprets the scriptures. So the Pope becomes the ultimate authority in the Catholic Church. And we, as Protestants, we don't believe in that. That's part of our Reformation. That's part of our history. As we came out of the Catholic Church, the thing that we emphasized on, the Reformed Fathers, they emphasized on the Scripture. They took the Scripture. The Scripture was what would replace the authority of the Pope. The Scripture became the ultimate authority. They call this sola scriptura. Sola scriptura, meaning Scripture alone is the infallible foundation for our faith. And everything is based upon Everything is based upon this. Now, here in the United Methodist, we have what's called a Wesleyan quadrilateral. And this was not termed by Wesley himself, but this is how Wesley came about to reason as he studied scriptures. And one of the things, during Wesley's time, and during the times of the Reformed Fathers, the scripture was the foundational. It was the objective truth. It was how they reasoned everything. And even though Wesley often talks about tradition and experience and reason, everything was based upon scripture. Everything had to conform to the scripture. But as time passed, of course, things change, right? As culture evolved, as times passed, things change. And as we enter into postmodernism, and we start to lose focus on absolute truth, on objective truth, and we start emphasizing more and more on experiential truth. We start to emphasize more and more on experience. The scripture takes the back seat. And our experience becomes the foundation for our faith. We start relying on our own personal experience in the faith. And there's one, and you know, experience is very subjective. It's very subjective, so that's the reason why we have so many people with so many different faiths, whether even though they're all in the same church, and everybody's divided. Because everybody promotes their experience above the other person. And so to hear the voice of God is something that we need to really consider. How are we going to hear? How are we going to seek out the voice of God in our church? How are we going to seek out the will of God in our church? How are we going to seek out the will of God in our own personal lives? Are we going to follow what the Reformed Fathers did? Or are we going to follow what John Wesley and his time they did? Or are we going to follow what, you know, during our time, when postmodernism started entering into our universities, with postmodernism, the idea, the philosophy of postmodernism started entering into our seminaries and then eventually into our churches, and we start to elevate experience in those scriptures. And so by doing that, everything becomes so subjective that everybody becomes divided. Everybody has their own experience now. Everybody wants to do their own thing. It's hard to bring people to be humble. It's hard to unite the church. One of the things that I ordained more often talks to me as Chang, how are you going to bring everybody together? And I say, you know what, this is something, this is a culture that's been going on for 70 years here in our United Methodist. I have no idea what I'm going to do. You know, because it's something that's been creeping into our churches for the past 70 years. The culture of elevating our own personal thoughts, our own personal experience over scripture. So it's very, very difficult. But I pray that God will continue to be with us as we learn to discern His voice in our own lives. And I'm not here to teach you, I'm not here to tell you what to believe in, but I'm here to tell you the history of how we've discerned God's will in the past, and how many people nowadays discern God's will. And so the things I want us to realize today is the first thing is that just as the child is able to recognize his mother's voice, it is very, very important for us to recognize the voice of God. Number two, I want us to realize that there are many, many voices that's battling for our attention every single day. And the third thing I want us to know is that there is a God who wants to communicate his will to us. It's up to us to choose which voice we listen to. Let us pray. Father, we come before you with humble hearts. Father, we ask that you lead us to continue to reveal your voice to us. Continue to reveal your will to us. Let us not seek after our own ways, Father, but let us seek after your ways. And so, Father, we lift everyone here up to you in the name of Jesus Christ, we pray. Amen. It's time for us to do offer to you. you continue to trust in the Lord.